Are bonobos domesticated versions of chimpanzees? Hi, I'm Krutik, I'm a scientist, and today we discuss some theories on how bonobos domesticated themselves.
In the dense rainforests of Central Africa, separated by the immense Congo River, live two populations of ape, which are our closest living relatives, the chimpanzee and the bonobo. They are an evolutionary fork in the road, as they have immensely different lifestyles. To the north of the river live chimpanzees, specifically a population referred to as the eastern chimpanzee, Han troglodytes Schwanfurthi. Chimpanzees as a whole are famously intelligent, curious, but also live in a society defined by intense male-led aggression, political maneuvering, and lethal intergroup violence. On the other hand, to the south of the Congo River live the bonobos, or pan paniscus. They are just as intelligent, but are known for their relative peacefulness. A society where females form powerful bonds and social tension is more often than not resolved through sexual behavior. On the surface, they are almost indistinguishable. Genetically, they are 99.6% identical, having only diverged around 2.6 to 1.5 million years ago. So, what could have possibly driven such a profound difference in their behavior? This question has led scientists to a fascinating and proactive theory that bonobos are not just a different species, but they are, in a very real sense, a self-domesticated version of the chimpanzee. The term self-domestication describes the process where a species evolves the same kinds of traits we see in domesticated animals, but through pressures of natural selection, not human intervention. And when we compare bonobos to their wild relatives, the chimpanzees, the signs are unmistakable. The evidence for this is written throughout their anatomy. The first piece of evidence comes from bonobos having significantly smaller bodies and muscle mass. While sample sizes in numerous studies on this topic have been small, female bonobos are roughly 17% lighter than their chimp counterparts, and males are roughly 10% lighter. The next piece of evidence comes from their skulls. Male bonobos exhibit a 10% smaller cranial capacity than male chimpanzees, whereas females are 4% smaller in their cranial capacity. In fact, an adult bonobo skull is dimensionally more similar to that of a juvenile chimpanzee, a classic sign of domestication known as neoteny. This is the retention of youthful-looking features in adulthood. The clearest example of this is in dogs, as our ancestors selected for friendlier, less aggressive traits to keep. By the way, if you are curious about the ancient evidence of dog domestication from wolves, do check out this dog domestication video if you haven't already. Other signs which show that bonobos are essentially domesticated versions of chimpanzees include their faces being shorter and the length of their canines being significantly smaller. For a male chimpanzee, large canines are essential weapons in conflict with other males. The reduction of these canines in bonobos points to a life with far less intense male-on-male aggression. And finally, sexual dimorphism. The size difference between male and females of the bonobo species is reduced when contrasted to size differences in chimpanzees. These 5 points form a consistent package of traits known as domestication syndrome, seen in animals such as dogs, cats, and livestock animals. But if humans weren't the architects of this change, what was? What selection pressure could have led to the diverging lifestyles of chimpanzees and bonobos? To solve this puzzle, scientists have investigated several compelling ecological hypotheses. One idea is a kind of island effect. The Congo River basin, where bonobos live exclusively, is geographically isolated. This isolation could have selected for smaller body sizes, a common phenomenon in island populations. However, this alone doesn't quite explain the dramatic shifts in behavior and social structure. Another interesting theory was around food availability. Perhaps the environment the bonobos live in was richer in fruit patches than the chimpanzees. If food is more abundant, animals can afford to gather in larger, more peaceful foraging parties. reducing interpopulation competition for calories. This would create the social conditions for females to form strong bonds and alliances, and could reduce the need for more aggressive behavior. But when researchers compared the ecological habitats between bonobos and chimpanzees, they found no significant difference in the overall availability of fruit. This led scientists to look for a different kind of ecological clue. What if the key wasn't what was in the bonobos' environment, but what was missing? And that would be their larger, tougher cousin. There are, in fact, no gorillas south of the Congo River. This simple fact appears to be the crucial piece of the puzzle. Both gorillas and chimpanzees rely heavily on fruit, and during lean times, when fruit is not as available, they both turn to a critical fallback food group, terrestrial herbaceous vegetation, which is a mouthful, so I'll refer to this as THV. And please don't confuse that with THC. North of the river, chimpanzees are in direct and on occasion violent competition with their much larger cousins, the gorillas, for this resource. Whereas south of the Congo River, bonobos have fruiting patches and THV food sources to themselves. That's not to say there aren't other animals such as elephants that eat THV, but bonobos and elephants are not in direct competition for the same type of THV. The ecological release from competition changes everything. When fruit is scarce, a chimpanzee troop must often diverge into smaller foraging parties. This decreases the amount of social connections chimpanzees can forge, and increases tension and interpopulation conflicts over limited food resources. But a bonobo troop can simply shift their diet to readily available THV on the forest floor, allowing them to stay together in large cohesive groups for longer periods of time. This ability to maintain large groups is the foundation of bonobo society. It allows females to form stable, lifelong alliances. Such stable alliances can be seen in display via over-sexual affections between female members of the bonobo troops, and a coalition of bonded females is powerful enough to dominate and suppress any rogue, aggressive males. In such an environment, a brutish, coercive male doesn't have a reproductive advantage. In fact, they would have a disadvantage. Natural selection in this environment would instead favor males who were less aggressive, more tolerant, and more socially adept. And the result of this is a neurological handbrake on reactive aggression driven by the absence of gorillas. And the final powerful piece of evidence comes from chimpanzees themselves. In the far west of Africa, where gorillas are absent, chimpanzees belonging to the pan-troglodytes versus population independently have evolved more bonobo-like traits, reduced male aggression, increased female social bonding, and more tolerant behavior. It seems where gorillas are not present and THV is abundant, the path to self-domestication opens for chimpanzees. Let's reconstruct this story. Around 2.6 to 1.5 million years ago, a crucial geological event occurred. The Congo River dried up temporarily and allowed a population of apes to cross onto the eastern bank. When the river refilled, it became an impassable barrier, isolating this population of apes from the rest of its species. The apes which remained on the north side of the Congo River shared their environment with gorillas. They evolved into the modern chimpanzees. The apes to the south of the river found themselves in a world without gorillas. With a reliable secondary food source, they could afford to forage in large groups. This social stability empowered females to form coalitions, and the presence of these female coalitions altered the sexual politics of the entire species. Two key products from these larger female coalitions have astounded researchers and ape enthusiasts for years: over-sexual nature of females of the species, but a more important factor is that these strong bonds led to female bonobos being able to use numbers to keep rogue and brutish male bonobos in line. A unique form of sexual selection occurred, where less aggressive males in the species had an advantage over their competition. Hence, it could be argued, the self-domestication event of the bonobos is partially consequential to some form of primitive feminism, Over millions of years, this pressure sculpted the proto-bonobo into a domesticated parallel to their wild ancestors. Now let's just hope the Congo River stays flowing, full of water, for the sake of these bonobos. The story of our two closest living relatives provides two very different mirrors in which we can see our own capacity for conflict and cooperation. I hope you enjoyed this video. Please share it, like it, and subscribe to the Scientific Journal Club for more science-backed stories about evolution, anthropology, and biology. See you next time for more science.